This one is lecture number 40, and here we will discuss about principal component analysis. And if time permit, then we will go to discuss about various derivation. There are various derivation for principal component, and further in next few lecture, I will talk about application of principal component analysis. Then coming to outline of today's lecture, I will talk about first motivation of the principal component. After that, I will talk about introduction. And if we are able to cover introduction completely, then we will go to discuss about few concepts from random vector concept. That means regarding random variable, you had already seen that if you are having a random variable, that then you will talk about what is the distribution of that random variable. And if you know the distribution, you can find expectation as a mean and variance. And suppose if you are having various random variable in together, that means you are having a random vector. In that case, you have to come up with covariance matrix for that random vector and mean vector of that random vector. Those things we'll see it here, because we are talking about data points. So data point happens to be always, if you take data point, it would be always in random vector, because various attribute would be there. It depends upon how many attribute you introduce, like height, weight, IQ, like body mass index, many different kind of pattern will come. Depends upon if you try to study a population, then various attribute would come. And if you try to proceed that population in a very compact way, then you have to come up with all the attribute in together. Then if you are taking the representation of all the attribute in together, then you will have a random vector. So we will talk about a few things about random vector and how to define covariance and other matrix and other kind of things. But problem is that we are having data point, we don't have the complete population information. So for that perspective, we directly can't calculate if covariance matrix is not given, we can't calculate that, because without knowing distribution, it is very difficult to know the covariance matrix. So what we do, from the sample we try to come up with sample mean vector and sample covariance matrix. So those things, and with the help of that, further we will do that component analysis, principal component analysis. Okay, so coming to first part of principal component analysis, that means what is the motivation, why we are studying principal component analysis. So it is really interesting from the several perspective. Here we will see that actually principal component analysis, it is concerned with the explaining the covariance structure of what we call it, that random factor. Random vector, I told that if there are various attributes, the data point, it would be in the term of random vector. So simply it is one representative of random vector, what we are calling it, data. This random vector is representative of a data point. And what we do, that means we try to explore the covariance structure of this one, and how we can explore this through a linear combination of these variables. So we will try to take, definitely it is a random vector, it will have a very nice covariance structure. That means covariance, we will able to find covariance matrix, and there would be variability. That variability we explain in case of random vector through covariance structure. So that's why I am saying that, and that by utilizing that covariance structure matrix, we will come up with one simple linear representation of this random vector. So we are talking about, this is given thing to us, and if it is given to us, at the first glance it doesn't look good. So in order to convert that into a better picture, we have to do some kind of pre-processing. That means we are trying to do some kind of better linear combination of these variables. And those, simply you can call those combination of linear combination as a latent representation of the current data point. So we try to find a latent representation, and same this latent representation also you can get it through neural network structure, that we are calling it autoencoder also. So here PCA is very simplest one, so in order to get a latent representation of data, whatever data you are having with the various attribute, you can get a very interesting representation. So here I am talking about motivation of PCA from the representation perspective right now. So it is one. Okay, once you are having a very good representation of the data at your hand with the help of covariance structure of the data point, then what you do, you can fulfill two purposes. There would be two purpose. One purpose that what we do, can we reduce the attribute, that means the, among the various attribute, few would be meaningless, few would not contribute a lot. Like if you, someone is going to talk about quantify the, that someone is having a cancer or not, for that that person is going for several tests. Among the several tests, various readings are coming. So you will see that among those various reading, only few are influencing cancer. So what we have to do, only those parameter which are influencing cancer will be meaningful, and rest of thing would be redundant. So we have to just remove out those things, those attribute. We don't need those attribute. So that means in the process of removing those attribute, what we do? We do reduction of the, in the dimension. That means we are reducing various attribute. Just effective, meaningful attribute we are keeping. That means we are just doing dimensionally reduction. So one motivation of PCA that through that better representation, we can come up with a better representation of the data. Better representation by truncating meaningless attribute. There would be various meaningless attribute. Another purpose of PCA is what from that representation once you are getting, then that one is that you can interpret that data in a very better way. In better way, like what we call it, if you try to see data at hand, then definitely you will see data would be highly correlated. If it is highly correlated, and if you try to do some kind of computation, then you will face problem. So what you do, if you try to after getting a that principal component representation, that what you do, you will see that just change the, what we call it, coordinates. Change the coordinate with respect to principal component. In that perspective, you will see that the principal component is having very interesting kind of property, that if you take any two principal component, happens to be perpendicular to each other. So due to that, what we say that the data which was uncorrelated, after applying PCA, it got a representation where we are seeing uncorrelated pattern. So due to uncorrelated pattern, computation is very simple. So that approach we will see it here. And simply I would like to say that if you are having PCA, then their data is very easy to visualize. And geometry, that if it is very easy to visualize, you can proceed with geometry a lot. You can do a lot. So one motivation that I am talking about from representation, dimensionally reduction perspective, that means how with the help of PCA we can reduce the dimension. Why we are also why we are going to reduce, why there is a need of reduction of the dimension, why we want to truncate few attribute, we remove up attribute. That means simply suppose we are having a data that one is not coming from what we call it Gaussian distribution, right? Suppose it is coming from something else, some any kind of distribution. It is not like that all the model are so data is sources from normal distribution. It may be any kind of distribution. So suppose one situation is coming like this way. Here you can see that we are having bivariate data. That means suppose x is height and y is coordinate, and we just do a scatter plot. We did a scatter plot of the these bivariate data. After this, what we observe that we see variability along a particular axis u, and there is one more axis which is perpendicular to the particular axis u, that we are calling v. Along direction v, we don't observe any so much significant variability of the data. Okay, so that's where we will see that u is most significant direction, and we will call it, this one would be first principal direction or first principal component, and v is the second most significant direction. And hence, because we are in 2D, there is at most only two direction possible. If you are at a point, there are two direction only is possible. Two in linearly independent direction is possible only. That why? Because dimension of 2D is 2. That's why. So here we can see that it is not what we do. If we change the coordinate from x, y to u, v, what will happen? Then data, it becomes just one dimensional. Why? Because u is only here meaningful having significant variance, but V is having insignificant variability. So we can just discard V, just we come up with U representation. So the this data has been just reduced here. We can see the reduction in the dimension of the data. So this data behave like one dimensional data kind of things. So in latent representation, so it is what we call, this one is the latent representation, and this one is original representation, and this we are calling it latent representation. So it is very much essential to know how to get U, how to get V. All these are very much essential. So from the data itself, we try to get representation of U and V. How we can get those things, we will see in this course. So here, as I mentioned, that we are having a bivariate data that are nearly linearly related. Okay, so we see the principal direction in which data varies. This is one principal direction in which data is varying. This one is the secondary principal direction in which we see a little bit variability in the data. So we here overall we observe two principal directions. U is the primary one and V is the secondary one. Okay. So here what we observe further, if you try to observe with respect to V, then V coordinate are very very close to zero. And why? If someone may have already told that it might be due to some kind of experimental error or measurement noise. Simply you can say that. So due to that it might happen. Actually data is one dimensional, but why we observe little bit insignificant measure along V? Why? Because data is actual one dimensional, but due to that measurement error, it happens that it becomes two dimensional and this noise we observe. So noisy, that pattern we can just for what actual data, it would be one dimensional, but when we measure it becomes two dimensional. So we have to get back to original dimensionality in order to perform better representation of the data. So that's why in that process we do dimensionality reduction. Okay, so here most significant, we can see that U is the most significant, and we will just keep U coordinates, and V coordinate we will discard. Why? Because those are very much near to zero, so insignificant to us in the transform space or latent space. UV is the latent space or transform space, simply we can call it. Another representation is application motivation for going for PCA is that we will get a better representation of the data. If suppose data is coming from Gaussian distribution, and then what will happen that definitely it is not always possible that the Gaussian would be always very simplest kind of Gaussian representation, that symmetric Gaussian or something like that. Symmetric Gaussian happens to be symmetric, but it is not like that symmetric about origin. That means very ascender kind of ascender Gaussian. It may not possible always we will get ascender Gaussian. So what we have to do, we try to do rasterization of any Gaussian to ascender Gaussian in case of higher dimensional data. So how we can do that? So that we can get with the help of again PCA, and that again I say that representation which would be in simple form we call it latent representation. We will see it here like this way. So one example we are having, if you are just measuring height and weight and only bivariate data, you are taking bivariate data. So just if you suppose generally, if you talk about distribution of the height and distribution of weight from people, and then what will the population, you will see that it happens Gaussian in nature, but that Gaussian may not be a standard Gaussian. So simply you can observe that here in XY plane we observe this kind of distribution of the data. These are coming like, if you try to do a scatter plot, then data is a scatter plot is like this way, this elliptical hyper or simply hyper elliptical, you can say it like this way. So what you do, so this representation, if you want a better representation, you can, what you do, you can apply PCA, and through that PCA you will get a better representation that we can represent it by U V. So U is the first principal component, V is the second principal component, and with respect to that we can observe that you can say that if you take U and V, the UV axis, you can say that it is latent representation, or simply you can say that it is coming with respect to principal component. U is the first and V is the second principal component. So in linear algebra you might have already seen that If you are having a matrix, if you are trying to find a symmetric matrix and if you are having a square matrix, then there you can find eigenvalue, eigenvector of that matrix. There are various name of eigenvalue, eigenvector. So one of the name is latent value, latent vector. Also we are saying that. So why? Because eigenvalue, eigenvector is giving latent representation of the actual things. Latent representation. So that's way. So able to. So that's why we are saying that from with respect to U and V, we are getting a latent representation of the data. And this representation is very interesting. That why? Because it is coming with respect to a standard norm. It can be described by a standard normal distribution. We will say that in UV plane, what is the center? Center is zero. What is the what easily we can find? If suppose it is unit circle, unit ellipse, then we will say that it is very much a standard normal distribution in UV plane. But if you talk about in XY plane, then in XY plane, it is not a standard normal distribution. It is something else. Why? Because with respect to XY plane, this mean is non-zero. This mean is in first coordinate, and the variance is something else. Okay. So that due to that, what that covariance matrix generally we will get. So if you talk about this data from XY perspective, so point, so it is coming from what? Normal distribution. Definitely it is with non-zero mean and covariance vector. Okay, but if you try to see it from the latent representation U and V, then U, V are having what? It is a standard normal distribution. Having a standard norm. It will what even this sigma dash what I am saying that sigma dash would be very interesting in sense that it will take a diagonal form. It will take a very interesting kind of diagonal form. Those we'll talk it later. So that's why this representation is very interesting. Why? Because from computational point of view, always we can do a lot of easy computation with this representation. That's why from the representation point of view, PCA is really very helpful. So okay, further I will talk about the associated. I told that if you are having a data point, then you need to know the covariance structure of the data point. That data set, you need to know covariance. There would be various data point in together that will form a data set. So if you are having a data set and with various attribute, then you have to talk about data matrix, then you have to talk about covariance structure of that. So various things will come, so we will discuss all those things in detail. Any question till now? No. If anyone is having any question, you can ask. Otherwise, I will go forward. So data matrix also I had discussed during first module as well. So again, I am recalling it here. So suppose you are having a random vector. Remember that when we are saying that random vector and the corresponding, we can calculate corresponding mean vector or expectation vector. That means if you know the distribution of this one. If you know the distribution of this random vector, then we can calculate mean vector. Okay. Also, we can calculate covariance vector. Covariance matrix. Sorry, covariance it would be matrix because various component of X is having. X1 is the first, what we call it. X1 is the first random attribute. X2 would be second attribute. Likewise, XP would be P attribute. So P dimensional random vector we are having, then we can calculate random the mean of the random vector just by finding the mean of each component, finding expectation of each component we can get it. Remember that for that you need the distribution function. Okay, next we have to find covariance matrix. Because if we are having a vector, then covariance structure would be in matrix form. So how we can find covariance matrix? Just take you have already calculated mean vector of the random vector. So what you do, you deviate the random vector by corresponding mean vector, that mean deviation what we are calling it, and do outer product with itself. So this one is the outer product. I had already described that if you are taking a vector and if you multiply with its transpose, that we are calling it a outer product of that vector. An outer product of vector happens to be matrix. So suppose it is n dimensional, A is n dimensional vector, then outer product of this vector A, it would be n by n matrix. And there are various interesting features. During that SVD, I had already discussed about outer product of vector and the rank would be one. So various criteria are coming. Okay. So we are defining here covariance as a expectation of outer product of random vector, mean deviated random vector. Remember that mean deviated random vector. So it is not a fixed number. There is a distribution of this random vector. So it is a random quantity, and we are finding mean of that. Due to that, rank would be affected here. We will see it here. So further, if you try to see explicit form of covariance matrix or covariance structure, what you observe with respect to each attribute, you can see it like this way. In the first row, you can take covariability with respect to first component. First row is in this covariance matrix, it is talking about covariability with respect to first attribute. Take covariability of all the attribute with respect to first attribute. In that process, this one is talking about covariability of first attribute with itself. So that in that process, what does it become? It becomes variance of first attribute. So you can denote it, it is variance of first attribute x1, and this one is what? It is the covariability between x1 first attribute and second attribute. So you can say that it is what? Second term in the first row, you can call it, it is actually covariance of x1 and x2. Likewise, you can talk about this one is what? This one is talking about covariance of x1 and pth attribute. Okay. Likewise, you can denote it. What is this one? It is talking about covariance of covariability of x2 with other all other attribute. So you can say that it is the first entry of second row, it is talking about variance of x2. Simply you can talk it, it is covariability of x2 with x1. So it would be okay. So that one was the actually covariance matrix, but at our hand we are not having complete distribution of the population, we are having just sample. So if you are having a sample, then how you can define mean vector? So we can't define mean vector, so we have to define sample mean vector, we have to define sample covariance matrix. So how we can define that? So suppose we are having n number of sample point, that means there is a sample of size n, simply we can say that, and each sample point is having p attribute. That means simply we are saying that among the population we have taken measurement of n population, measurement height, weight and other kind of thing for n number of population only. Now n number of people we have taken measurement for n number of people only. So that's why we are having a sample of size n. So that one is a very feasible thing. So from that measurement of n number of person, that those measurement of n number of person, we have to come up with mean vector. This one is what? It is a random vector. Okay. So there are n number of sample points, n number of random vectors, simply we can say that. So in n dimensional, simply you can say that you are in a n dimensional space. In n dimensional space, you are just having information about n number of points. Sorry, no, you are in p dimensional space. In p dimensional space, you know about only n number of points from that p dimensional space. So if you know about that only n number of points from the p dimensional space of p number of attribute, then how you can define mean vector? That mean vector would be just define it through sample mean. So we are defining it sample mean, that means summing up all the value of first attribute for all those points, all those n points, and dividing by n. Then we are getting this one is the mean of first attribute x1. Likewise, this is the mean of pth attribute xp. This is the mean, sample mean of pth attribute. From that n data point, we are calculating sample mean vector. Again, it would be a vector. Now we try to calculate sample covariance. So we are defining here, we are taking that Bessel correction, that 1 by n minus 1 in place of 1 by n. Why? Because this representation we had already seen that it is an unbiased estimator of variance. So that's why it has an unbiased estimator of covariance. So that's why we are proceeding with this one. So covariance, again, we are defining with respect to n number of sample points. So this is the definition of covariance matrix, sample covariance matrix. And now what we do, we can simplify this representation of sample covariance by introducing data matrix. So what is data matrix? Data matrix, it is just what happening that you are having a random vector x, and you are taking n measurement of that random vector, n measurement. That means you are having a sample of size n. So the first row is coming with respect to what? First measurement of the random vector. And likewise, nth row is coming with respect to nth measurement. So you are having n number of measurements. So if you are putting those in matrix form, in compact form, then you are getting a matrix. So this matrix is actually, we are calling it data matrix. So data matrix, generally, if you see variability along this way, column variability, what does it vary? Attribute vary. This one is first column is talking about first attribute, second column is talking about second attribute, and fifth column is talking about fifth attribute. So attribute vary. So it is very much essential to understand that data matrix in a better way. So this first column is dealing with what? First attribute x1, and the fifth column is dealing with all the n measurement of fifth attribute. And if you talk about variability along what we call it rows, so variability along rows, what we talk about? We are talking about sample points. Sample point observation, also you can say that sample point. You can better call it sample point. A person, what person you have taken, so you observe. So this one, the first row is coming with respect to first person or first, that means the first sample point. Second row is coming with respect to second person or second sample point. Likewise, nth row, it is coming with respect to nth sample point or nth person. So that's where this is your data matrix. So with respect to data matrix, we can easily express sample covariance matrix as what? How? 1 by n minus 1 times x transpose x. So this one is always you can say that here n would be fixed to you, so you can forget about this representation. Just keep in your head this one, you can keep somewhere, then you can say that this x transpose x, it is talking about covariance, sample covariance matrix with this vector. So it is giving a value of sample covariance matrix. So it is what? It is one kind of one estimator, point estimator of the covariance. And we know that we are having that sample of size n we are having. So this one is easily computable. We can compute this one. And one more thing, anyone may comment over that this metricity of this one, whether this covariance matrix would be symmetric or not. Anyone? No answer. The difference between notation I have already taken in note, that bold letter, capital X, bold, in bold it denote random vector, and this one, this capital X simply, this denote data matrix. I need your participation. If you are unable to answer, simply it means that you don't understand all this. Later you will
not get a better application of this course.
So we are going further. We have already expressed sample covariance matrix in term of data matrix. So here data matrix is everything. So come up with data matrix from the given sample, come up with data matrix, and from that try to find this one. Also we can get representation of this mean vector in term of data matrix as well. So what would be that? It would be very simple representation. 1 by n factor would be there. And what we do, we have to take here x transpose the data matrix with one vector. So capital 1 I am writing, one vector, and I am taking here suffix n. Here we see that the data matrix, so what is the order of data matrix? It is n by p. So the here order of x transpose would be what? P by n. So that's why we are taking here one vector, n dimensional one vector. What is meaning of n dimensional one vector? Here all the entry of this vector, one n dimensional one vector, is what? 1. It is coming like this way. This one is one vector, so that's way. So this one is again, you can mean vector, you can express with respect to data matrix, and also the sample covariance also you can express with respect to data matrix. So all about, if you are having idea of construction of data matrix from the given sample of size n, then easily you can define all these sample mean, sample covariance matrix. And if you try to go for explicit representation of sample covariance matrix, then you can define it like this way. This is the explicit representation of sample covariance matrix. And if you try to represent further sample covariance matrix in more, what is happening that the representation, it would further come in the category of this way. Simplification is coming like this way. Actually, this is not a correct representation directly, we can say that. We can simplify it. Little bit deviation we have to do it, and this here we are taking it identity matrix. Anyhow, x transpose x is coming there. X transpose x is coming there. Little bit deviation we have to do it, and then x transpose x is coming here. This one is identity matrix. Okay. Now we will talk about further linear combination of the attribute, and how we can take benefit of linear combination. That means here we are having a random vector, that means of dimension p random. That means there we are having p number of attribute. First attribute is x1, second attribute is x2, and likewise fifth attribute we are having everything vector. If you are having, always we write in column as a column vector. So that's why transpose I am putting it here. Okay, so we'll talk about a better representation of this one. How? Through linear. That means we are talking better representation. That means we are taking all possible various linear combination of this one and trying to transform the input space to another space of the same dimension. Another space of the same dimension. So that space we will call it latent space. Right now call it latent space. Later we can we will have a freedom about latent space, that we can reduce the dimension based on our requirement, what representation we are getting. So consider the following linear combination of the attribute. So first linear combination, we are taking it like this way. This is the first linear combination. Then if you are taking first linear combination of the attribute, all the p attribute, so and if you are willing to find variance of this first linear combination of those attribute, so easily we can calculate variance, that we denote it by z1. So that means simply you can say that if you are willing to find v1, that right now we don't know, but later we will come to know v1 would be the first principal component. Later we will see that. Okay, so with respect to V1, that means we have projected all the data points in the direction of V1. So simply this linear combination, first linear combination, we say that we have projected all the data point with P attribute, with all those attributes in V1 direction. So that's why we are getting a linear combination. So V1 is here very interesting. V1 is what we have to decide. We have to come up with one V1, suitable V1, and we are projecting all the data points along the direction V1. In that case, we are getting a linear representation, linear combination of all those input. Okay, what is happening that now? Next, can you find a variance of this linear, this first linear combination of all the data point? Yes, we can calculate easily. So this variance of this Z1, it would be in term of variance of X. Covariance of X. How? And also that the direction in which we are projecting all the data points. So it is one easy to calculate. Why? Because we are having idea about this covariance of X, and we are having idea about V1, that in which direction we are going to project all the data points. So that's why it is very easy to calculate variance of linear combination of input. If you take another linear combination of the inputs, so we are having this kind of linear combination. Okay, again, if you, and that we denoted by Z2, and if you are willing to calculate variance of Z2, then easily you can calculate this. Simply here, this one is talking about original data. What you are coming with, original data, okay, data points, attribute of original data point. Or simply you can say that original attribute. With original attribute, okay. So after that you are trying to introduce derived attribute. These are derived attribute that you are getting through linear combinations, some linear combination or specific. So V1, V2, with respect to V2, we are getting Z2 is another linear combination of attribute. And if you are willing to calculate the variance of Z2, that means we are projecting the data, all the data points in the direction of V2. And if you are willing to calculate what is the variance of that projected data in the direction of V2, then it can be expressed. We know that we are going to project in the direction of V2. So take the quartic form of that V2 with variance of covariance of the original attribute. So original covariance matrix, what we are calling it, this one. So we can easily calculate the covariance of projected data with the help of covariance matrix of the original attribute, covariance. Likewise, we can talk about pth projection of the data points, all the data points that we are projecting it here. That's a variable, random variable notation is coming here. Capital A, one is talking about random variable. So that if you if you're projecting all the data point in the direction of VP, then we can denote that it by ZP. And what is the variance of ZP? Again, it can be written as a quartic, this quartic form. And sigma is known to us. Sigma happens to be covariance matrix of the original attribute. Okay. So what we observe that simply if we transform the original attribute, so what we are having by a matrix V to Z, we can say that it is latent attribute, or latent input also you can say that. A latent representation also you can say that. Better right now call it latent representation, or this one is original attribute. So if you are doing that kind of approach, here overall that how you can come up with a suitable V, that you have to find it. This one is original attribute. So all about that you have to find a suitable V, and PCA will give a suitable V. Similar kind of concept we will perform through that, we can perform through auto encoder as well. So that I won't cover here. So very easy to find here the covariance of this transform a latent random vector z with the help of covariance of random vector x, and with the help of the matrix through which we have transformed this, we brought this transformation. So it is all about how we can get a best v, and PCA is providing a best v that we will see it here in the introduction segment. So what is PCA? Simply I would like to say that what is PCA. So PCA, it is simply one kind of statistical technique. And what do what exactly PCA do? It uses an orthogonal transformation. So V, that one was a transformation or simply a matrix, simple kind of matrix. There was no any information simply, but PCA is giving a very good idea about estimate of V, or very good estimate of V, that V happens to be an orthogonal transformation. That means simply you can say that V is an orthogonal matrix. If you are trying to talk about finite dimensional data points, and then it is an orthogonal matrix. What is property of orthogonal matrix? Property is that if a matrix O, we will call it orthogonal matrix. If you first criteria is, if you I talk from definition point of view, the column of orthogonal matrix happens to be orthonormal vectors. So orthonormal vector, due to that, what is happening that if you multiply a matrix with its transpose, then it will be resulted to identity matrix. So that is the benefit of the orthogonal matrix. And it is coming that columns happens, if you take columns of orthogonal matrix happens to be orthonormal vector. That means if you take dot product of any two column of orthogonal matrix, then it would be equal to 1 when I equal to j. That means if you are taking dot product of column with itself, then it would be equal to 1. That means that one is a unit vector. Apart from that, if you take dot product of any two column, different column, then sorry, here in this case equality, here it would be, if you take dot product with any two different column, then dot product would be 0. That means any two columns are perpendicular to each other. If you are taking any two different column, those would be perpendicular to each other. So that is the property of orthogonal matrix. So here PCA, it is a one kind of statistical technique that uses V as an orthogonal transformation to convert a set of observation of correlated variable. Remember that original data would be correlated to you. You have to apply orthogonal transformation to convert that correlated data into uncorrelated data. It is the ultimate representation of what we call it, representation of data that we are getting through PCA. Okay, and orthogonal transformation, what we are getting, the columns of that, we are calling it principal component. The direction what we will get, those we will call that principal component. That means column of orthogonal transformation. Okay, now what further it talk, this one is one thing, it is talking about representation. Now there is one more thing apart from that orthogonal representation of the data, uncorrelated representation of the data in the latent space. We also see that it finds direction with maximum variability. That means if you are having V1 is the first column, V2 is the second column, likewise if you keep on going V, because we are having P number of attribute, then VP, P number of principal component we will have. And what we will see that in the direction of V1, the projected, if you try to project data in the direction of V1, that one is having maximum variability, maximum. Then V2, in the direction of V2, we observe second most variability. In the direction of V3, we observe third most. Likewise, P3 would be the direction in which we see least variability of the data. Least variability of data. So that's many things. It is talking about variability of data as well. So principal component, if you talk about what are the principal component, so simply principal component are uncorrelated and orthogonal linear combination z1 up to zp, whose variances are as large as possible. Okay, So these are having maximum variances. Z1 will have maximum, then Z2 will second most, likewise. Okay, so PC, all these PC, Z1, Z2, GT, these are forming a coordinate system by rotating the original axis or rotating the original system x1, x2 up to xp. So p dimensional, that we had p dimensional data space, we have transformed to another p dimensional data space that we are calling it latent space, we denoted by z. And how we are doing that transformation? We are doing transformation through these vi's. These are the direction through which we are transforming. These are the direction in the process of in order to get all these transform direction. Transform representation of data. So Z1, Z2 or Z, these are actually transformed data or projected data. So Z1, you can say that Z1 equal to V1, what I had already expressed, that Z1 equal to V1 transpose X1. V1 transpose X in the direction, all the data we have transformed into in direction of V1, and ZP is likewise, what is this? This one is VP transpose X. That means all data point we have projected in the direction of VP, and hence we are getting ZP. We are getting ZP. That and here Z1, Z2, ZP, all these are what? Principal component, and those are uncorrelated. That is the concept. Whose variance, variability, we can say that. And these are simply, we can say that these are the projected data with the projection is coming through V1, V2, V3. Okay. Now, if you are willing to visualize, then we can visualize like this way. Do we have time? No, just I will talk about visualize. After that, I will wind up. So, suppose you are in 2D, then largest principal component is the direction that maximize the variance of the projected data. That projected data we denoted by Z1. Then largest principal component is the direction that maximize the variance of the projected data most. And this smallest principal would be the component that maximize the variance least. There would be only two directions. So two situations you will see that. So it is to having this situation, that two dimensional data. So this is your first principal, that component, and this one is your second principal component. V1, you can call it. We are projecting data in the direction of V1. In that process, projected data we denote it by Z1. We can do V1 transpose, multiply with data matrix directly, you will get it. And this one is what? V2. So what are the projected data along this direction? So we can denote it by Z2. So Z2 is V2 transpose X. So likewise, this representation, that is the visualization of principal components. So other thing we'll discuss in next class.